Hi there everyone, my name is Dr. Nikki and today's lightboard video aims to step you through a big picture overview of the muscles of the lower limb. So I've received several requests asking me for ways to simplify or break down the muscle groups, their collective actions and the individual muscles that act upon the major joints of the lower limb. And so this then inspired me to create this lightboard using a flowchart approach to help you to sort of break down or get your head wrapped around how the muscles are organized. Let's start off with the bony pelvis. This is going to provide, I suppose, an anchor point for muscles that are going to stem from the trunk to then insert onto the pelvis to allow us to move the lumbar spine, for instance, and the trunk. And it's also going to provide, I suppose, the origin that's going to help us to move major joints such as the hip. So I personally like to break the muscles down into muscles that attach to the anterior surface of the bony pelvis and then muscles that attach to the posterior surface of the bony pelvis. Anteriorly, we will then find psoas minor, psoas major, as well as the iliacus muscles. You will also remember that psoas major and iliacus will then come together to form the iliopsoas muscle, which is going to be a major or primary hip flexor. If we think of the common actions of these muscles, they are either going to act upon the trunk or they act upon the hip. And they're primarily involved in flexion. So psoas minor, for instance, is going to have the role of being an assistant flexor of the trunk. Psoas major is going to be involved in trunk flexion as well as flexion of the hip. This is the same for iliacus. And then iliopsoas is involved in a whole range of actions. But as I mentioned, it is going to primarily be a hip flexor. It also contributes to external rotation of the hip, rotation of the pelvis, as well as lateral flexion as examples. Attaching then to the posterior surface of the pelvis, we then tend to find two groups of muscles, or what I think of as two groups. So superficially, we then have our glutes. So remember with our glutes, there are three gluteal muscles. From superficial to deep, we have our gluteus maximus, our gluteus medius, and then deepest, we have the gluteus minimus muscle. At this level, I try to remember what is common amongst individual muscles in a particular group. And when we're looking at gluteus medius, maximus, and minimus, they are all going to insert onto the greater trochanter of the femur. In terms of their common actions, they're all involved in abduction of the hip. However, some of our individual muscles may also then have additional actions. So for example, gluteus maximus is also involved in extension of the hip, external rotation, and it can also perform adduction. Whereas gluteus minimus, on the other hand, along with abduction, it can also flex the hip. And then finally, if we then strip these away, we're then going to find some of our deeper, smaller muscles that are involved in lateral rotation of the hip. From superior to inferior, we're going to find the piriformis muscle. We're then going to find the glomellus superior, obturator internus, glomellus inferior, and the quadratus femoris muscle. And these five tiny little muscles are all going to be lateral hip rotators. We could also, if we're coming back to the muscles that attach anteriorly, we could also think about what are some of the longer muscles that have to cross the hip joint, originating or coming from the thigh, that are also going to act on the hip. So technically you could include rectus femoris and sartorius under this category. However, for simplicity's sake, I think it's easier to include these in the compartments of the thigh. So if we're then moving distally from the bony pelvis and had to look at a cross section through the thigh or the femoral region, I want us to think about the arrangement of the muscles in terms of compartments. There are three main compartments within the thigh. Starting off with the anterior compartment of the thigh, this is going to house our quadriceps muscles. In the region of the inner thigh, almost medially, we then have the medial compartment, and then posteriorly, we have a posterior compartment. So we can arrange the muscles in these three specific compartments. And remember that compartments are going to be separated from one another by a fascial layer, and typically they have a common nerve innervation as well as a common artery supplying the muscles in those groups and a vein then draining those specific muscles. Even without us going into individual muscles just yet, we can think about each compartment as having a core muscle group. It is also going to have a primary action, and it is going to have a single nerve that is going to innervate the muscles in that group to help them to perform that collective action. So thinking about the anterior compartment of the thigh, this houses the quadriceps muscles. All of the muscles in this group are also innervated by the femoral nerve. Located then in the anterior compartment, we have the four muscles that make up the quadriceps. This is going to be rectus femoris, vastus lateralis, vastus medialis, and then deep to rectus femoris, we have vastus intermedialis. Sartorius is also classified in the anterior compartment. Depicted by the asterisks are individual muscles that are considered to act upon two joints. So these are going to specifically act to flex the hip, so rectus femoris and sartorius. They are also going to extend the knee. Let's then move on to the medial compartment. Collectively, the muscles in the medial compartment are responsible for adduction of the hip or thigh. So this is going to then include our major group of adductors, that is adductor magnus, adductor longus, and adductor brevis. The common peripheral nerve that is going to provide motor supply to these muscles is going to be the obturator nerve. The individual muscles located in this compartment are going to be those adductors, as well as the gracilis muscle, so our small, gracile, long muscle that runs most medially through the thigh. And then we also have the pectineus muscle classified in this compartment. And then finally, in the posterior compartment, we have the muscles that in layperson speak are classified as our hamstrings. And the hamstring muscles are only going to consist of three fairly big muscles. The common action of the hamstrings are to extend the hip and to then flex the knee. These muscles receive common nerve innervation by the sciatic nerve. So more specifically, the tibial branch or the tibial nerve, with the exception of the short head of the biceps femoris muscle. The three muscles in this compartment, starting from medially to laterally, will be the semitendinosus, which sits on top of or is superficial to the semimembranosus. And then laterally, containing two heads, we have the biceps femoris muscles. And then lastly, let's have a look at the organization of the crural region. The leg can be divided up into three compartments. So once again, we're going to have an anterior compartment, we have a posterior compartment, but then we also have a lateral compartment. Starting off big picture, when we're trying to locate the anterior and posterior compartments, these are going to be relative to the tibia, which you'll remember is going to be that big medial load-bearing bone that you find in the leg. So the muscles then in the anterior compartment are going to be our primary dorsiflexors of the ankle. You will also remember that dorsiflexion can be referred to as extension of the ankle. So if these are going to then comprise of our dorsiflexors, our plantar flexors are then found in the posterior compartment. Our lateral compartment then contains the muscles that are in relation or around the fibula. So they have fibularis in their name. The reason I've included flexion and extension in the descriptors is because the muscles in these compartments will also extend the toes or flex the toes or the digits. The common action of the muscles in the lateral compartment is going to be eversion of the foot. Located then in the anterior compartment, we see a muscle that is going to be coursing anterior to the tibia. So our first muscle is going to be the tibialis anterior muscle. This muscle, along with primarily dorsiflexing the talocrural joint, is also going to be responsible for inversion of that subtalar joint. We can then use the mnemonic Tom, Dick, and Harry to then remember the other smaller muscles in this compartment. So Tom refers to tibialis anterior. Dick is going to refer to something that has the term or the word digitorum within it. And then Harry refers to something that has the word hallucis in it, so acting upon the first toe. As we mentioned, collectively, these are going to be muscles responsible for extension. So we're then going to find our extensor digitorum longus, our extensor hallucis longus in this compartment. Finally, there is a fourth smaller muscle located or classified in the anterior compartment. And this is going to be the fibularis tertius muscle. In the lateral compartment, we only have two muscles. And as I've mentioned before, these are going to be in relation to the fibula. So I personally prefer the terms fibularis longus and fibularis brevis muscles because these are easier to remember. Their collective actions are eversion, and they can also produce plantar flexion. And then finally, in the posterior compartment of the leg, we tend to then divide the muscles into two layers. So we have our superficial muscles, and then we also have our deep muscles in the posterior compartment. So superficially, we have our really, really big muscles that are primarily responsible for plantar flexion. Specifically, we have our gastrocnemius and we have our soleus muscle. Together, these are going to plantar flex the talocrural joint. Gastrocnemius is also going to be responsible for knee flexion because it crosses that knee joint. If you want to get technical, we can technically also classify the plantaris muscle into the superficial compartment. Then, if we're moving on to our deep layer of the posterior compartment, this is going to be a mirror image to the anterior compartment. But now remember, rather than having extension, we have flexion. And rather than having a tibialis anterior, we have a muscle that is coursing posterior to the tibia. So this is going to be tibialis posterior. So again, following the Tom, Dick, and Harry mnemonic, we have tibialis posterior, flexor digitorum longus, and flexor hallucis longus. We can also then classify a tiny little muscle that is responsible for unlocking the knee, that is going to be the popliteus muscle in this layer. The final thing that I'd like us to cover is going to then be the nerve supply or innervation to these compartments. So you will recall that the sciatic nerve, just above the level of the popliteal fossa, once it passes through that adductor hiatus, is then going to bifurcate into the tibial nerve and the common fibular nerve. So the tibial nerve is then going to course through the popliteal fossa, and it is going to run through the posterior compartment. So all of our muscles in that posterior compartment, as well as the intrinsic muscles on the plantar surface of the foot, are supplied by the tibial nerve. The common fibular nerve, on the other hand, is then going to course anteriorly, laterally around the head of the fibula, at which point it will then bifurcate or split into a superficial fibular nerve and a deep fibular nerve. So the superficial fibular nerve is then going to course with the fibula, and it supplies the muscles in the lateral compartment. This also is going to receive sensory innervation from most of the skin on the dorsum of the foot. And then finally, the anterior compartment is then going to be supplied by the deep fibular nerve. So I hope that this provides a simple overview of how you can summarize the major muscles of the lower limb into big picture compartments. And then from there, think about what is the collective action of that compartment? What are some of the common origins or insertions? Or then think about what is going to be the peripheral nerve that is going to supply motor innervation to the muscles within that group. You can then from there break it down into the individual muscles within a compartment and think about what are some of the more specialized or unique characteristics that are specific to that individual muscle. Thank you so much for your time, and please make sure to check out some of my other videos on my YouTube channel that aim to break down complex concepts in a simple manner.